Welcome to the Open to Hope Show. I'm your host, Dr. Gloria Horsley, with my daughter and co-host,
Dr. Heidi Horsley.
This show is brought to you by the Open to Hope Foundation, whose mission it is to find hope after loss. Well, Heidi, we've got a great group today, and we are going to talk about getting real with your grief, aren't we?
Absolutely. We're going to talk to five bereaved parents, like you said, about getting real with their grief, mm-hmm. how they got real, what helped them, and what didn't help them.
Mm-hmm. All right.
And it's interesting, Mom, because all five of these guests have been on our show before, and all five have lost sons. And I lost my brother, you lost your son, so I just thought that was an interesting common theme, too.
Absolutely, really. Why don't you introduce them, and then, after you introduce them, I'm going to have them just give us the name of every child that they've lost.
Oh, I like that.
Because whether you know it or not, and you probably know it if you've had a loss, you want to hear your kid's name, don't you?
Absolutely.
Yeah.
So Scott is my brother.
Right.
Okay, so let me start closest to me. Annah Elizabeth.
Mm-hmm. Hi, Annah Elizabeth.
Hi.
She is the author of Digging for the Light and the developer of the Five Facets of Healing. Next to her, we have R. Glenn Kelly, also known as Ron.
Hi, Ron.
Hello.
And Ron has written a book called Sometimes I Cry in the Shower. He's written numerous books. He's written The Grief Case. He's written a book on grief in the workplace, and he is a speaker all over the country. Next to him is Barbara Hopkinson, and Barbara.
Barbara.
Hi, Barbara. She is the founder of A Butterfly's Journey and is the creator of The Faces of Resilience, among other things. All of these people have done a lot, so if I say it all, it'll take us all day.
Everybody's going to want to go to their websites,
yes,
and look at it all.
These are the leaders in the field, Mom, and this is a very condensed version of all the things they do in the grief and loss world.
Mm-hmm.
So next to Barbara is Dr. Tanya Lord.
Hi, Tanya.
She is the co-founder of the Grief Toolbox and the director of patient and family engagement at Foundation for Healthy Communication. And next to her is
her co-founder.
Yes. Both Dr. Tanya Lord and Glen Lord founded the Grief Toolbox. So,
it's a great online resource, by the way.
Yes. Glenn is also the founder of the International Grief Institute.
Mm-hmm.
And again, they speak all over the country and are experts in grief and loss.
Okay, what I want you to do is I want you to mention your son's name, and you can say how old he is or something special about him, and we're going to put up their picture. So go ahead.
Oh, well, Gavin Michael was born May 11th, 1990. He died 26 minutes after he was born to unexpected delivery complications. He will be 29 in May, and even though I never had the pleasure of knowing him outside of my womb, in this life, I still have a connection with him and a bond that is undeniable.
Absolutely.
I'm still making memories with him.
Okay, Ron.
I am the father of Jonathan Taylor Kelly. Jonathan was born in 1997 with a rare but not rare enough congenital heart defect known as hypoplastic left heart syndrome. So the day they handed him to his mother and I, they said he's probably not going to make it through the night. But he did. Went through some difficult open heart surgeries, three of them before he was the age of two. Given a prognosis for a full life with some intervention along the way, but unfortunately, during a routine heart catheterization, his heart failed, mm-hmm. and he took his final breath in my arms.
Hey, Barbara.
Yes, my 21-year-old son, Brent, who is about to be an Army pilot, died in a motorcycle accident at age 21, and his younger brother, Robbie, was full-term stillborn. Mm-hmm. And that was in 1987, Brent was in 2002, and then I lost a baby in a miscarriage in 1980.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm. So Tanya, who's gonna speak for you too? Tanya and Glenn.
I can tell you that Noah died in 1999 from a series of medical errors following a tonsillectomy. And one of the things that led us started down that road was that he had a speech impediment, and his favorite restaurant was Fuddruckers. Except he didn't come out that way. So he was 4 years old, and so we had a couple years there of quite embarrassing moments with our little kid guy.
Well, you threw out a shout out for your brother, so I'm going to throw a shout out for my sister too. Uh-huh. And so I'm also a bereaved sibling. My sister Heather's also died from metastatic breast cancer.
What about it when somebody says, get over it?
Get over
time
what?
Time
for what?
Hasn't
get
been
what?
Long enough. What is the it?
Yeah,
get over it.
Actually, if I can just jump in, I just wrote an article for you at the Open Hope website about that cliche, time heals all wounds. Mm-hmm. And for some people, it's very uplifting and motivating and inspiring. But for many of us, and I don't know about my fellow guests here, but it's heart-wrenching and frustrating. And what I like to say is time doesn't heal all wounds, but we heal ourselves in our own way in time.
Mm-hmm. I like that.
Mm. In our own time.
I think I tend to say, really, have you had this kind of loss? Do you know what you think timing should be? Because it's very unique, and you can't, you just can't guess, you can't judge. Mm-hmm.
Mm-hmm. I tell people that we don't live in a society like we used to, and we should, because there was a time where we mourned, and we mourned ritualistically, and we mourned long-term. Mm-hmm. Everybody will recognize this. I have the most loving, immediate family in the world, that when I lost John, my house was inundated with family that traveled from across the country and supported me and loved me. And then we put John in the ground on Sunday morning, and Monday morning, everybody was gone. Mm-hmm. But they had to. That mourning was gone. Mm-hmm. So yes, they will get over it. I will not. And I expect them to get over it, because they don't return to a home every night where that child who used to fill that home with love is no longer there. So no, we won't get over it. But there's a mask that we put on, and we show it to others in public. And we show them a false mask of I'm doing okay when we're not. So when they look at us and go, are you over it yet? Yes, we do want to punch them in the throat. But sometimes we kind of give that impression that we are getting over it, as it were. Mm-hmm. We'll never get completely over it. We'll transition into a life of peace and purpose, but we'll never get over the loss.
I love the peace and purpose.
Yes. And what about you, Tanya and Glen?
Well, I guess, you know, I kind of asked you, get over what? And I think what they mean when they say get over it, they mean get over kind of the fact that we're in this place that they don't want us to be. So really what they're asking us is to make their lives comfortable. And I think that when they're saying that, I think it's important to really, what we can do to help them make their lives comfortable is help them recognize that if they want us in their lives, they're also having our son in their lives. And I'd love to be in their lives with my son in their life, but that's the condition under which it happens. And if they want that, then great. If what they want is me without any of the realities of what happened with that, that's no longer an option for them.
Mm-hmm. I think it's about recognizing the connection. So I try to help people understand that if they have children who have grown and gone off to college or live on their own, nobody's saying to them, really, do you still talk to them every day or every week or every month, maybe? You know, do you still want to see them at holidays? Why, like, isn't it time to cut that connection? And I think especially with, for children who have died, the connection's still there. So there's nothing to get over. The grief, the raw pain of grief can change and soften a little bit, but there's the connection is still there. So to me, it's no different. Our other children are adopted, so I have one birth story, and if women like to talk birth stories, and if they talk birth stories, they're going to hear about my one birth story.
Mm-hmm. And Mom, I've always wondered about the idea of closure. Mm-hmm. So we hear people out in the world talking about asking, do you have closure? Have you found closure? What are your thoughts about that?
Yeah, and you see it in the newspaper too.
Yes.
Where and I hear people talk about it on the news all the time.
Yes.
They it helped them. They arrested the guy who murdered somebody or something, and helped them find closure. Or I hear it at the end of an execution or something. The families finally had closure, or they're not going to get closure.
Or even in general, you know? I've heard people ask me, Heidi, do you have closure? Mm-hmm. Have you found closure? I mean, in any, you know, after. So, what are your thoughts about that?
We don't close, we transition. We just move forward. Yeah. We transition to a life where we've adopted our future. I've always called it, people have heard me call it blueprints before. Before my loss, I had a blueprint of my life that was designed around spending my life eventually being a grandfather and having grandkids and being able to spoil them. And then against my control, and we use that word control a lot, against my control, somebody took those away. So I can't close that, but I can adapt my blueprints now, and I can transition into a different set of blueprints I didn't want originally, but I've got them now. So I'll transition into that, and I will, again, find a life of peace and purpose.
Mm-hmm. You know, I'm not sure if I'd call it exactly closure, but I think over time, when I started to realize that my son's life was more of a gift to me than a loss, mm-hmm. and if I had to choose between never knowing him and doing it all over again, I'd do it all over again.
Yeah.
So you know, and knowing that he wants me to be happy and to heal, and knowing that I can now focus on the positive memories and think of him a little differently, that helps me a lot. It helps me feel, you know, very healed, and it makes me, it feeds my purpose to help others.
And the people that I'm working with, I personally call it resolution. I believe grief is the conflict that is attached across all of our five facets. So for me, it's the resolution of the conflicts that comprise our grief that create what some people would call closure. But when I'm working with people, I ask them, what does that mean to you? What does closure look like to you, or resolution? What word would you use? Because it is different for everybody. I once used the word with somebody, resolution, and that infuriated her, because what that meant to her was different than what it meant to me.
The closure is for bank accounts, not for love accounts. Yeah. And I think that really sums it up very well.
Yeah.
So
that's our friend Bob Niemeyer.
Yes, good, because sign. To me, closure means a door is closing or a relationship is ending. And as you all know, and I want to ask Tanya what comes up to for her about closure, but as you all know, when Scott died, I closed, I mean, my relationship with him on the earth physically was gone, but my relationship has never ended with him.
Mm-hmm.
I don't have closure on that relationship, nor would I want to. We have a new relationship in a different way,
mm-hmm.
because that's all we can have. I'd rather have him here, but I don't have a choice, so we've continued this bond.
Mm-hmm.
Tanya, what comes up for you with the idea of closure?
So after Noah died, we had a lawsuit, and when that lawsuit was done, there was sort of a collective sigh of relief from our friends and family that, okay, good,
now they've got closure.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. But it didn't change anything for us. It took a certain piece of what happened to him and gave maybe a little bit of explanation, not very much. But so I guess I never related or one way or the other to the word closure, because it didn't make sense to me. Mm-hmm. The idea that somehow I could conclude, I guess what you said, conclude that relationship, and somehow that my missing him was going to change.
Mm-hmm. And there's so many tendrils and so many layers and so many pieces.
Different interpretations.
So we could have quote unquote closure or resolution, mm-hmm. or whatever you want to use, mm-hmm. on one particular
piece. Or maybe just cleaning out the closet or getting rid of their
umbrella. But that doesn't mean that it's an umbrella closure. It doesn't mean that you have something that you've resolved, or whatever word you want to use, that means everything is closed.
Yeah. So I guess I would say, now that you said that, is we moved. Noah died at home,
mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
and we moved from that house.
Mm-hmm.
When within that first year, so a lot of people were saying, no, you can't make big mm-hmm. decisions in that first year. We moved from that house, and moving from that house released me from a weight that house had, because being there was continued mm-hmm. kind of the trauma around his mm-hmm. death.
Yeah, mm-hmm. I find it was easy. I don't know if you guys, but sometimes it was nice to go someplace where Scott had never been with us, mm-hmm. on vacation or whatever. Did people find that?
Yeah, in fact, there's certain places that I like going, and there's a certain one. In the opposite side of that, my favorite place I ever went in my life was with Prince Edward Island with Noah, and I never want to go back there again, because mm-hmm. to me, mm-hmm. it's a magic place, and I want to mm-hmm. keep it.
Yeah. But it might give you closure.
It might give you closure. But I love the memory as it is, and I don't want to confuse the memory with added memories. Yeah. So that place is there.
One thing I want to talk about is forgiveness on this show, because does that resonate with people?
I'd like to say, because we talk about some of the things that we run into with people out there, and one of the things that I always espouse, always advocate for, are some of the people that do the most stupid things towards us as grievers. Even the ones that say, are you over
it
yet? They're uncomfortable in mortality. Everyone's uncomfortable in mortality. Mm-hmm. For my coworkers, when I went back to work to look at me, those that had children looked at me and went, oh, but there, but for the grace of God, go I. Mm-hmm. You know, what if I lost my child? How would it be? And they're uncomfortable, and they turn and go the other way. And I know they do some horrible things and say some horrible things. Mm-hmm. But people don't go out and get trained to support others in grief. Mm-hmm. We have to think about what we're going to say. But we're all born to comfort someone who's in pain. And usually by comforting someone in pain, I'm going to approach them, and I'm going to say something to them, and I have no idea what to say.
Mm-hmm.
And it's going to come out. So forgiveness for me, when that the knee-jerk response for forgiveness is forgive others. They have no malice behind what they do when they say some really, my biggest thing is somebody looked at me with a 16-year-old child who was gone now and said, well, at least you don't have to worry about college tuition anymore. And I wanted, trust me, there were some things that, but I walked away and realized
it took you a while to get to forgiveness with that one. Let's be honest here.
I realized it was a certain level of IQ I was also dealing with too, so I forgave some of that. But people don't have malice in what
they do. I'm going to ask Tanya something which I think is really a hard one, and Glenn, is how do you forgive yourself with the medical error?
That for me was the hardest one. And honestly, I would say that there's even moments today I have, if I'm going to be brutally honest and say, I don't forgive myself at times. I want to, and there's other times when I'm in complete forgiveness of myself. But there's moments when that can still sneak in, because I think to forgive yourself is really the hardest thing there is. Because anytime you're forgiving anyone else, it really is about forgiving yourself. Because I think that society confuses this concept with forgiving with saying that it's okay, and it's not. You can forgive someone and have it not be okay. Yeah. You can forgive someone, it doesn't mean that there aren't consequences associated with it. But when it's yourself, you're struggling with that whole piece of it and realizing that the consequence is something now you're living with. And even if you're not directly, in our case, we did everything correctly.
Right, that's what I thought. I was like, wait, why do they have to forgive themselves? Well, I'm confused.
When your child has a tonsillectomy and you take them,
and you're responsible for scheduling.
I think there was a series of decisions, and for me, in our family, I make the medical decisions of what kind of surgery, what kind of treatment did he need, when to have called the doctor when things were going poorly. But I can tell you that I did not forgive. I was Noah's only chance. I was CPR certified. Wow. I was his only chance when he hemorrhaged at home. But I found my own forgiveness when 10 years after he died, I met with his surgeon and recognized how much his surgeon had suffered the loss of Noah and other patients as well. I'm sure the cumulative loss. And I forgave him before I forgave myself, but forgiving him gave me the permission that if it wasn't his fault, if I could forgive him, then I could certainly forgive me.
I love that. That's beautiful. Mm-hmm. You know, I think one of the things about being a parent is parents take care of their children. And I think there is a certain shame and a certain thing that you sometimes have to get over.
When my brother died, my mother was in D.C. with him, and she didn't know this for years. She didn't remember saying this, but she called me on the phone. And she was crying, and she kept saying, I'm so sorry that I let him die. I'm like, what are you talking about? Mm. Like, for me as a sibling, I didn't understand that. She goes, but I was supposed to protect him, and he died. Okay. I'm his mom. Mm. And I'm like, Mom, you couldn't do anything. So me as a sibling, I want to come and rescue all the parents that is so, right. I'm like, I can't hear this. It's not your fault. It's not your fault. Yeah. It's not your fault. Because, but you know, as a parent, you think this.
Yeah, I've run support groups for parents and grandparents now for like 16 years. And what I also hear is that's a tough one when you've got to forgive yourself. But there's a lot of anger, especially in a lot of kinds of death, where people are really angry with other people in their family or their spouses or because of accidents or, you know, things that were not so accident. But forgiveness is really not about them. It's about you. You forgive somebody else for your own good, not for them. Because they may or may not care. They may or may not know. But it'll haunt you unless you work on forgiveness.
Remember Craig Scott, his sister Rachel was killed in Columbine, was very violent with his brother and everything for a whole year after. And then he had a minister talk to him and say, not forgiving yourself is like holding a hot coal in your hand and trying to say it's going to burn somebody else.
Right, exactly.
Because he'd had a fight with her before she was killed. So I want to get to one other thing. Let's talk about friends really quickly. Forgiving friends. How did you find your friends? Did you have some friends that blew you off or some friends that couldn't handle it or, you know?
I think there are relationships of all kinds, be they work, home, family, that do change when we have a loss because, A, they can't identify or they're closed off or it resonates differently with them than it does us, but also we become different individuals. Mm-hmm. And so sometimes we change and move forward in ways that others aren't willing to come along with us. And it is difficult. I mean, I had family who, for years, immediate family, that would not say Gavin's name. And we host all the holiday functions. And so they would come over, and I would say, bring up Gavin's name, or say we were going to the cemetery, and the conversation would change. I don't know how many of you have experienced that. They would change the conversation. Mm. And for me, that hurt for a very long time. Mm-hmm. But it was probably 20 years in, 18 years, when I realized that that was their way of handling their grief about what happened. And so, as you said, it's about releasing yourself from the conflict that's attached to the other person. And once I was able to have empathy for them, then I was able to basically forgive it all.
So, so I wanted to ask, okay, what's the shortest time that it's been? Is it 11 years?
No, mine's almost 7 now.
Oh, 7. Mm-hmm. Okay, and anybody shorter than that?
Uh-uh.
And the longest is probably us.
36
years. Okay.
29.
Maybe 20 this year.
Yeah. 17.
Okay.
I'm junior.
Yeah, you're the junior guy here. So what I want to make the point is that we're here still talking about it. Mm-hmm. We're talking about it for you because we want you to know that life goes on, that we have a great life. Do we have a great life?
Yes,
we do.
Absolutely.
Yeah. Do you feel like you've personally grown? How many people feel like they're personally grown?
No doubt.
Yeah. But I didn't start there. And if you,
that's why I'm saying 7 to 35. So if you're listening, I just want to give you
it's
hope for the future
process.
On this show. We all want to give you hope for the future. That's what this is about. It's not about that you're not going to be grieving right now. It's tough at first, isn't it, guys?
Absolutely, and I still miss Scott a lot, and I still feel very gypped that he's not here. Even though I live an amazing life, it pisses me off that I don't have a brother.
Yeah. So let's go around and give everybody one quick tip if they've had a loss. Got you through, got you resilient.
Hold on to hope.
Hold on.
If you are a parent out there and you've lost a child, take it from me, you are still a parent. Especially for those of us that only had one child.
Thank you, I love that.
We are still
so
a parent.
Important.
Right.
You
are.
Be good to you and trust your gut. Don't rely on opinions of others. Rely on your own gut about what's good for you.
You're right. Tanya.
Similarly, trust the journey. Mm-hmm.
Oh, I like it. Trust the journey, Glenn.
There's all kinds of
one of the greatest parts about for me for healing is what we're doing right now, sharing as bereaved individuals.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
Take the risk to share with other bereaved individuals. Mm-hmm. Find an environment to do that. The reward will bring you great, great healing.
Okay. Mm-hmm. All right. Well, thank you all so much for being on the show today. It's been great.
Thank
we're
going
to hear Paul Alexander, our singer-songwriter, and he is going to sing Who Am I? Which is a tribute to a person that we, many of us know and love, Darcy Sims, which is really amazing.
Well, and written for Allie Sims about losing a sibling.
Yep, on her 18th birthday, I do believe. Well, we want to thank you all for watching the show today, and we hope that you'll tell everyone about it and that you will take care on your journey and find resilience. And Heidi and I also want to remind you that if you've lost hope, please lean on ours until you find your own, and visit us to Open to Hope, and God bless.
This next song, Who Am I, was written as a birthday gift for Allie Sims. And back going some years now, her mother, Darcy Sims, and dad, Tony, requested that I write a song for her 18th birthday. And Allie, following the death of her little brother, Big A, had written a book called Am I Still a Sister? So I read the book and got inspired to write this song as a gift from her parents to her for her 18th birthday. So here it is, Who Am I? You and I, we were a team. It seems we fought against the odds. You and I, we'd paint rainbows when the world would fall apart. We'd laugh and play all day. We'd make angels in the snow. We were two, you and I, me and you. Who am I now without you? Who will I turn out to be? I stand alone, broken in two, Does anybody realize how much I'm missing you? You and I, we'd play the music box and giggle in the sand. You and I, we'd look for shooting stars when our fears got out of hand. We'd close our eyes real tight. We'd make a secret plan. Oh, we were two, you and I, me and you. Turn out to be. I stand alone, I'm broken in two. Does anybody realize how much I am missing you? Does anybody realize how much I'm missing you? You're still with me, like the air I breathe, and the sun that fills the sky forever. You and I.